Hey, welcome to Pizza Box Computer. I'm Sophie Haskins. Today, I'm going to take this Pizza Box workstation, an HP 712 running NeXTstep, and turn it into a powerful 1990s development workstation. This video is part two in a series about running NeXTstep on pa-risc. If you haven't seen it, you might want to check out the link up in the corner to part one, where I set up the machine and install the NeXTstep operating system. I'm going to pick up where that video left off, right after the OS install, and make the machine useful. At this point, it would be reasonable for you to ask, Sophie, what do you mean by useful? Isn't this machine obsolete? Some of the useful things other people use retro computers for are running modern operating systems like NetBSD or Linux, accessing their old files from back in the day, or playing games like Doom. What I want is to get a sense of what it was like to use this machine as my workstation when it was contemporary. I want to experience it in the context for which it was made. So for me, it's about getting the applications that people who use the machine would have had for what they would have used it for. The biggest selling point of NeXTstep workstations was their object-oriented development tools, so it's time to find and install some software. If my goal involves installing software, one of the biggest efforts will be getting the software to the machine. What are my options? Floppy disks were common, but my machine doesn't have a drive. Even if it did, they're annoyingly low capacity. I could burn some CDs. That might work. But as I mentioned in my last video, I think my CD-ROM drive needs some repair. Plus, burning CDs is really annoying. When I installed the OS, I used the SCSI to SD as a fake CD drive as well as the hard drive. Swapping CDs requires taking out the SD card and a slow copy. More trouble than I think it's worth. The best option, in my opinion, is going to be networking. What do I need to transfer software over the network? Starting from the bottom of the stack and moving up, one, a physical connection to my network. This part is easy. The HP 712 has an Ethernet port on the back, the normal kind too, not a 10Base2 coax connector or only AUI. It's only 10 megabit, so it'll be quite a bit slower than modern standards, but it uses the same connector and works with the same switches like the one on my desk. Two, an IP address in my subnet. This is a bit more complicated than it is with modern computers, but it's not terrible. NeXTstep won't act as a DHCP client to be assigned an address automatically, so I'll have to configure a static IP. To do that, I use the helpfully named simple-network-starter.app and fill in some basic details. I'll call the pizzabox HP 712 and give it an IP address of 192.168.1.200. I happen to know that address is free on my network. Just to be sure, I'll tell it that my default gateway is 192.168.1.1, mask is 255.255.255.0, and broadcast address is 192.168.1.255. Three, the ability to talk to a file server. In my case, the file server is my NAS. This is the hardest step. Naively, I'd expect I can use nfsmanager.app to configure mounting my NAS. If you try this out of the box, it doesn't work. It turns out that we're missing a step. DNS. not just because it's nice to be able to use names instead of IP addresses, but also because NeXTstep NFS seems to require working reverse DNS for my workstation. On my home network, that's handled by my router when I make a reserved IP. On the Pizzabox side, I also have to manually tell the workstation how to find the DNS server. While there seems to be no graphical way to configure DNS, it does use the same etc/resolve.conf that other Unixes do. With DNS in place, I can set up the network share. Even though my NAS is approximately 20 years newer than this workstation and OS, they can speak the same protocol and share files. Now that this is working, it's easy for me to transfer files from my modern computer. I could browse the web and download things I want to install and copy them over to the NAS. No disk burning or floppies required. What'll be the first thing to install? System updates. I'm running NeXTstep 3.3, released in February 1995. The first patch update was released a few months later. The follow-up versions of NeXTstep were released as OpenStep over the following years, and Next itself was acquired by Apple in early 1997. That wasn't the end of updates for NeXTstep, though. Apple did ignore patching older versions at first and focused on merging NeXTstep with the macOS, first as Rhapsody and later as macOS X. But they released final patches for their old operating systems in mid-1999, both to the final release of NeXTstep 3.3 and the final release of OpenStep 4.2. Why did Apple release patches after years of nothing? For Y2K compliance. That's not all, though. They also fixed some long-standing bugs. Win. There's still a few Next enthusiast sites that host the packages, since Apple's FTP servers are no longer accessible. To apply the patch, I download it, copy it to my NAS, log in to the workstation as root. In order to do that, I need to set a password for the default me account. Otherwise, if I log out, it just automatically logs me back in as me. Okay, now let's log in as root. While I'm here, I'm also going to set a password for the root user. Then I navigate to where I put the package on my NAS. And I install it. The update takes just under 4 minutes. Now it's time to install the good stuff, developer tools. I'm going to get this going in the background while I explain what's going on. This part can take quite a bit of time. Like I said in the introduction, the developer tools are the centerpiece of what NeXTstep is about. Back then, though, companies didn't give away dev tools for free. NeXTstep User without the dev tools cost $799, and NeXTstep Developer with the dev tools cost a cool $4,999. That doesn't mean that I need to reinstall the OS as the developer edition, thankfully. The difference between the two is that developer came with a second CD of DevTools to install on top of the user edition. I happen to have the installers from that second CD sitting right here on my NAS, so I'm going to install them. There's four parts to the developer tools install. documentation, libraries, tools, and sources for the GNU tools as required by the GPL. Each installs pretty simply. There's also a patch update for the developer tools, so I'll install that while I'm at it. The whole DevTools install took me about an hour. What's included in the toolbox? If you've done macOS or iOS programming in the past 20 years, they might be familiar to you. There's Project Builder. It's sort of like an IDE, but without an editor built in. It helps you manage the different kinds of files that make up your software sources. It runs builds, it lets you choose how it's all bundled up as an app, etc. Over time, it did grow an editor. I remember trying out Cocoa tutorials in Project Builder on macOS 10.2. Eventually, it became Xcode.app. Interface Builder, a tool for drag-and-drop building of interfaces. When you're making a desktop application, you need buttons, text fields, etc., and you want to hook them up to bits of your code. IB is how you did that on NeXTstep, and remains the way you do that with OS X today. There's Icon Builder for making application icons. DB Modeler for laying out database schemas. I don't have a Sybase DB to connect to, unfortunately. Header Viewer for discovering APIs. And some other tools. There's also a bunch of demo apps whose source code is available as examples of how to make Next apps. Some, like File Merge, are useful dev tools in their own right. Some, like Boink Out, are games. You might recognize the chess app as surviving all the way to modern OS X. There's a sound recorder app with a cool waveform display. Unfortunately, the audio hardware in the HP 712 is...
Well, let's see.
It isn't amazing.
There's even a screensaver app with a knockoff of the Amiga Bouncing Ball demo. A lot of this stuff might look old hat or unimpressive to the modern eye. Of course you include examples in documentation, but remember, the developer tools were the center of NeXTstep's value proposition. There's a link up in the corner to a Next marketing video from 1991, where they have a Next developer and a Sun developer do a bake-off building the same application. Naturally, the Next developer gets it done far faster and has more flexibility for future improvements. As Next's VP of Software Engineering, Avi Tavanian, bluntly says at the end of the video, Next tools are ideal for industries where you use custom software to make money. If you can develop that software faster, you can make more money. Of course, even if custom software is a big part of your business, you're also likely to need some normal office applications for more mundane tasks. There were plenty of developers and publishers working in the Next market, but one of the most prominent was Lighthouse Design. As Next faded in the mid-1990s, Lighthouse was acquired by Sun Microsystems, who imagined that they might build a competitor to Microsoft's Office using Java on Solaris. Since they were no longer going to develop their Next software, Lighthouse made perpetual license keys available for free online. I've got a bunch of their installers and keys on my NAS. Installing them all took me about 45 minutes. Let's take a look at some of the apps. Some of the highlights are OpenWrite, a pretty decent word processor. In fact, I'm using OpenWrite to do a draft of the script for this video right now.
Hey, I'm not done yet.
Parasheet, a classic spreadsheet program. Concurrence, for making presentations. including with the intention of printing them on 35 millimeter slides because it's 1995. Then there's Equation Builder for typesetting math without using tech typesetting tools. Wet Paint, an image editing program. It's not quite Photoshop, but it's far more than MS Paint. And OmniWeb, a web browser published by Lighthouse but written by the Omni Group, a company who survived the transition from Next to Apple and still exist, and technically still have OmniWeb. There's Diagram. The exclamation part is part of the name. Taskmaster, for planning projects and making Gantt charts. Quantrics, a database-y spreadsheet program similar to Lotus Improv. This still exists as its own company. And VarioData, a networked database builder. Think of it more like FileMaker Pro or MS Access, less like MySQL. There's certainly more to the world of NeXTstep professional software than just Lighthouse Design, but they're a key part of the story. These aren't simply ports of existing software from other platforms. They clearly use NeXTstep UI elements and concepts to their full. With just a little work, some network setup, a couple updates, and lots of software installs, my HP 712 has gone from a blank slate to a powerful workstation. So what's next? I want to develop an application. I've got a few ideas bouncing around in my head, but I'm not going to do it immediately. My next Pizzabox posts and videos will probably be about other machines and other topics. Once I circle around back to the HP 712 and NeXTstep and learn about using Next's object-oriented tools, though, I'll be back with a video walking through that process and giving my feelings on what it's like to use a powerful workstation from 1995. If you have any experience using NeXTstep, any of the software I've shown in this video, or any other NeXTstep software, tell me about what it was like in the comments below. I'd love to hear about other people's experiences. Also, if you'd like a more in-depth look at this and other Pizzabox projects, check out my blog. There's a link in the description below. And thanks so much for watching.